Hello, welcome to another tutorial video. This is an excellent poem, the right word, mainly because it gets us thinking about language and the words we use. So even though here it's actually talking about the the connotations of in the degrees it talks about, terrorism, freeze fire, hostile, militant, etc., the way we see the kind of other, it can be applied to anything, just in terms of the word best or the word worst or the word hate, etc., and just thinking about all the degrees and connotations that we link with them. It's a fantastic poem, but we'll go through this in general, specifically going through it with smile as ever. So we look first of all at the structure, and we've got these short stanzas, and they actually show that the person's coming to very quick judgments. So they're just kind of hitting out ideas very, very quickly, and obviously that's important to the theme as it goes, because we're actually thinking about the language. The language change once the person starts thinking. Now the thinking itself is actually reflected in the use of questions. So the first conclusion is made, that statement, sorry, is made, and then we have a question actually thinking and considering what that is, and we have another one here. So the first one is actually thinking about, have I actually made the right choice in that, have I actually made the right choice by using that word? And then the second one actually starts to question what words in general, what do they do? And so that's a level one thought, and then this is like a level two thought, because obviously a building from that one. And there are no more questions throughout the poem, simply because once we get to that point we start questioning everything and maybe start seeing things how they were. And so that part there, is really interesting, because it's thinking for yourself, and it's only in thinking for ourselves, maybe where we get to see more common ground than just listening to this kind of words other people using. And that's just one way of looking at it. Another really interesting structural feature, this is the changing definition of what we've seen and the action all the way through. So it starts off in the most terrifying way, and then it ends up in just this really kind of soft and loving and homely, unified way. So it's kind of like an inverse triangle, an upside down triangle, where everything's just kind of coming in to a point from being so distant, but it all comes towards us at the end. The reason that's important is because it really focuses on, once we start thinking beyond our fears or actually trying to confront some of our fears, what could happen with some of our ideas and etc. And I'm sure you've got loads of examples in your own life where you had a stereotype or prejudice, and then when you worked towards dealing with it, you found that it really ebbed away. And that's what the reader's inviting us to do here with the terms used, especially the very commonly used terms, etc. Interestingly, it offers no judgment on the right or wrong of the terms themselves. It's just the idea of trying to connect with the people rather than the term is going to make a difference. So moving on to the meanings, well, we've got the just to continue on that, it's not just, because I've only looked at the words here. So you've got the terrorist becomes a freedom fighter, becomes a militant, becomes a warrior, becomes a martyr, becomes a child, etc. But also the way that they are moving, hanging in the shadows, that's really important. So they go from lurking to taking shelter to waiting to watching, etc. So not only does the person there change, but the tone or the atmosphere around them changes as well. So look at what happens and changes in the shadows, and the fact that it actually changes all the way through is just showing the power of the thoughts and how thinking and watching and waiting before making, jumping to conclusions, actually makes a difference. So what themes do we have? Well, the first one obviously that comes through is fear, this fear of the other, this person outside, and that's really represented by the fact that outside is the first one, is outside of my sphere of fear of knowledge, outside of my sphere of reference, outside of my realm of understanding, outside of my comfort zone, whatever it is. That word outside represents so much in that. And then from there, that's where we have our fears, because it's something outside, it's something we don't know, something distant from us. Second of all, we get this feeling coming through towards the end of common ground and all the things that we actually share. So we see here, we have this child that looks like mine, and we have a child, that a boy that looks like your son too, and this person comes and eats with us. So that common ground being referenced there is the common ground that maybe we should try and get to actually find unifying threads between us, rather than using these labels that are actually mentioned earlier to separate and split us. Third thing I picked up on, this the reason I like the poem so much, is it's all about language. It's all about the words that you use and what they could then mean and how it could then be put. You can completely set someone up in someone else's eyes, you know, in a sentence. If you say, hey, we're going to go meet so-and-so later, he's or she's blah, 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 you're literally going to prejudice the person's understanding of what's going to happen, or how they're going to take the person, or, you know, whether you like it or not. And that just that language power, you know, just one person be able to transfer information to another person, and the words that they use, sorry, the words that you transfer that with, is just going to make all the difference in the world to how the other person's actually going to understand it. And when you think about the mass media and how it kind of affects us and how we actually look at people, talk about people, discuss people, it's massively, massively important. And, you know, a few changed words in a lot of our daily discourse, you try it, try and find out a way of speaking. Say, I'm sure you do it already, actually. I'm sure you speak to your mom differently, you speak to your dad differently, you speak to your teacher, especially when you want something or you're trying to make your own point. You know, you can't speak to them all in the same way, or you can, but it's not going to be the most effective way of speaking to them. And just the idea of language control, the power of our words, etc., that's really important. Also brings us to thinking about the prejudices that arise from the words that we use, and obviously the connotations we have with them. But that's quite an obvious one, especially in this case when we're using a word like terrorist. What knowledge does for you, and what patience could do for you? That's like a secondary thing I just wanted to bring up, because remember, through thinking about it and actually considering it, this poet or this person actually watching through, actually considering it and going through their options and thinking about it before they act upon anything, the only action this person does apart from watching is to invite the boy in. So it's actually showing you, if you're patient and you look and you understand, you try and reason, then you can come to a connection, etc. I think that's quite an important message to actually be taken. So we look then at images. I really like the idea of the image that's really striking of the darkness outside, you know, just the shadows. I think that's really important, because it doesn't just represent the darkness in and of itself, but it represents the dark area to us that the other person might be from, not literally as in skin color, but like in terms of the lack of knowledge we'll have about a race or a people or a culture, etc., and be fearful or be frightened of it. And obviously that darkness there comes with the idea of something sinister. It's just the natural association before we take steps to try changing that. The image of the morphing figure, what it becomes, you know, what you can say, you know, kind of grenade laden terrorist who suddenly becomes this, you know, sword swinging freedom fighter who becomes this bomb creating hostile militant. You can just see all these images kind of being created until it becomes this little boy who just kind of walks in and takes off their shoes, and it's just, you know, a massive transformation. And just to have one image change so much all the way through a poem is really challenging. Can you take that all the way? Can you make the person change as the person sees it? Or did you see it when you read the poem as 7 or 8 different people coming in, change and change again? Or did you actually take the principal idea and change that? So I think it's an interesting idea to run with. We got the image as well of the poet watching, you know, and just imagine the look on their face as they decide, oh, hold on, no, it's this. How scared are they there? How scared are they there? How scared are they there? How surprised are they there? How shocked and, you know, touched are they by then, etc., etc., and then what's going on here? So you think of the poet as well and how they're watching it and what that brings home to us about this, the fear, the change of fear, or how knowing a bit more and watching and waiting to gather all the information actually makes a difference. And also I've mentioned the changing shadows. You know, the shadows are either influenced by the character that we're looking at them in, or they influence the character. So by the time we get down towards the end, we've got this boy, yes, lost in the shadows. Okay, so this child now is lost in the shadows, whereas before the person was lurking. You know, they were using the darkness to their advantage, but now here this person needs help out of the darkness. So the change of the shadows around them, I also find really a really powerful image. So with the language then, we've got this, the words out and in, or outside and in, repeated quite a lot. So at the beginning you've got outside, 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 and then towards the end we have the excuse me, come in, the child steps in. So then there's the, just cements the unification, cements the joining, you know, from the split that we had at the beginning, and the distance that we had in the beginning, because the darkness in that way and the shadows can actually be seen as a barrier as well, because we can't access that person properly because of whatever barriers that are actually there in the shadows, known or unknown. And then that's worth extending and actually taking and thinking about further. We've got language, you've got you used a couple of times to actually directly involve the reader, to actually make us think about what it is we hold, what it is we hold that is similar. You know, how would we see things from another point? How could we put ourselves, in someone else's shoes and see why they do what they do? And also we've got the repetition that's actually all the way through. And that's just a technique just to keep us in the same place but change it slightly. This slight molding, you know, this general ebbing away at kind of the idea, you know, just washing it down into something else. And that's only done by keeping the same idea. Obviously, in that way, you'd have to keep a lot of the same words and repeat them to let you, the things that you change then become all the more important. So you go outside the door, outside the door, outside, outside your door, and then it just kind of little bits change just to change your whole perception of it. So read through it again and see how it changes and what you actually think about as you're going through. And you've also got alliteration here, you know, just really bringing the power of the actual, bringing the power of words home to us, because it's really making us focus on that section. So the effect on the reader then, well, it makes us think about our prejudices and, you know, what we believe and don't believe and what kind of associations we made with certain words, etc., etc., etc. It makes us think about what we hear and react to. So when we hear certain words, not only just like what words do we have, but when we hear certain words, you know, how does it make us feel? What does it do to us, positive, negative? What words are used to actually trigger us, etc.? I mean, I think it was Philip K. Dick who said, he who controls words, he who controls words controls the people that use the words. And that's fascinating, because there's a lot that can be said. I mean, obviously, if you've read 1984, then you've probably got some idea of the whole philosophy behind this, whatever Orwell's intentions were. But the idea of being able to, if imagine if you could take some words away from the dictionary, what would then happen? Or, you know, if you wanted to kind of like, you remember, I think it's quite a common one, you might have come across the enhanced interrogation, or the phrase enhanced interrogation. There's quite a new term in our lexicon, in our dictionary almost. You know, before we just kind of call that torture, and then, but now, you know, because of the situation that we're in, we just develop new terms and new words for, well, that's not torture, it's enhanced interrogation, etc. So there's hundreds of different examples you could think about that. So it just makes us think about how we hear and react to, and obviously things are softened for us then. You know, the diplomacy with which words are used to try and ease things is quite good. It's actually, obviously, if anyone is interested in linguistics, it would be really, really good study element to actually see, develop that. But sorry, I've gone on too long on a side point. And lastly, we actually think about other people's motives here. Why could other people be using those words? What do they want us to associate with them, and what do they want us to think?